Okay, so just to continue, so one of the questions that I mentioned before that I think maybe we should go back to and sort of clarify this question first, because it pertains to the particular context of chapters 13 and 14, is that chapters 13 and 14 are, as I understand them, commentaries on statements in chapters 1 and 3, okay? So chapters 1 and 3, we have actually Shinran speaking. In chapters 13 and 14, we have the kind of interpretation of issues that are related to the statements in 1 and 3. So let's look at 1 and 3, okay, which are not very long, and then we'll see how these things are related. Okay, that makes sense? So, therefore, and ultimately, you know, I think a big deal of what we're talking about here is this term, okay? Which unfortunately, you know, since it translates the same as akunin, as this term, okay? So whether these are really the same thing or not is another issue, but we're going to talk about that also. So so I gave you a lot of, like, this term aku, right? Akunin, evil person, is the way he always translates it. And I gave you some examples of different ways to think about aku right here. We talked about that before: harm, danger, disruption, etc., inappropriate behavior, or for me, what I think is most relevant here, karmic insecurity. The phrase in chapter 14 is zaini. Okay, and this is, both of these are tricky. These are words that are very colloquial, very much contextually determined. And so let's talk about that difference. So, you know, all of this pertains to the notion of sin. Sin is a very tricky concept because it has such heavy baggage coming from Western religion, right? Mm-hmm. And in some sense, there's an overlap with the Judeo-Christian notion of sin, and in some sense, there isn't. The first thing I suggest you think about is that there is a team. Well, so if you don't know Japanese, this word is, it's Japanese reading it, sumi. As opposed to aku, so sumi is zai, okay, of zaini, okay, meaning this person, right? And then the other one is waroshi, okay, in classical Japanese, or ashi, two different ways of reading this character. So this is zai. That's one, and then Wadoshi is aku. And so, one of the reasons that, and I'm not the only one, of course, that people have trouble with a lot of the translations coming that are in the English language Shinshu universe, is this conflation of a lot of terms. So, example, in the Kyogo Shinshu translation that comes out of collected works of Shinran that everybody uses, I see it here. We have, because Shinjin is such an important term in Shinshu thought, it's often left untranslated. However, there's a lot of, Shinjin is often explained by other words that are also translated as Shinjin, like Shinge, for example. So the translator decided that it really refers to Shinjin, so they just took all these different words, even Shin by itself, they call it Shinjin. So you see Shinjin over and over and over again in the Kyogo Shinshu, which is not actually what's happening. Shinran does not use that term that often. It's a misrepresentation. There's a purpose to that. It's not, you know, irresponsible. It's just they're trying to show you what the theological current understanding of how to read Shinran is for Nishihonganji. Nothing wrong with that. But if you want to go beyond that, or you want to understand why they're doing that, you know, or how these words work, then you have to think about the broader context and you have to be more precise. Shinran is doing, he's using these words in particular ways for particular purposes. Mm-hmm. Okay. So as I said before, part of this is the context of what scriptures he's reading, right? The use of these words in Buddhist scriptures, right? And as the other meaning is the use of these words in Japanese society as Japanese words. So we talked about aku before, and I, you know, because I've lectured on this topic here before, I didn't want to bore you guys with the same thing if you've heard me say it already. For those of you who haven't, you probably want to know what I want to say, but just to keep it limited, again, back to the Nirvana Sutra. The Nirvana Sutra is the second most quoted text by Shinran after the larger Amitabha Sutra. And it's particularly, it occupies 40% of the chapter on faith in the Kyogyo Shinsho. The chapter, that, by the way, I believe they even translate the title of that chapter as a chapter on Shinji, which again is not what Shinran says. It's about believing or faith. You know, Shinjin is a part of that, right? So, if you think the whole purpose of reading this is to get to Shinjin, then therefore you can say, yeah, this is what this is about. But that's not the way Shinran structures it, okay? So that's, again, that's an interpretive layer laid on top. It has its purpose. But just to be more literal, you know, in any case, why does Shinran quote the 40% of that chapter, which is the heart of the book? Why does he quote the Nirvana Sutra? It's not a Pure Land text at all. Amitabha is barely mentioned in it. Amitabha's in there. Doesn't occupy a prominent role. This is a constant kind of irritation for modern Shin people who don't read the Nirvana Sutra. They don't know what to do with it. The Nirvana Sutra is most famous for its doctrine of Buddha nature. Why is Shinran talking about Buddha nature? Well, that's also in the Kyogyo Shinsho repeatedly. Why, you know, how do we deal with that? Okay, So we have a kind of conflict in terms of the way this is currently passed down to us. And, you know, I don't want to be too critical. I just want to present to you another aspect of this situation. So the thing that's really most important, and I've said this before, you've heard me say this, is that in the Kyogyo Shinsho, Shinran says very directly, great Shinjin is Buddha nature. Mm-hmm. Very clear. Shinjin is Buddha nature. So what does that mean? If, in fact, the Buddha nature that he's referring to is in the Nirvana Sutra, and that's the only Buddha nature text that he quotes, and he quotes it repeatedly, over and over again. In fact, we recently, in Japan, it was recently discovered a whole series of Nirvana Sutra quotes that Shinran wrote out by hand that never got published, okay? The last thing he was working on before he died was another Nirvana Sutra essay, okay? So important to him. This raises big questions because in the Nirvana Sutra, the way they talk about Buddha nature is every living being has Buddha nature. It's not an abstract heavenly idea. It's in the essence of every person and every animal, right? And every hell being and every ghost, okay? So, if in fact the Tannisho is talking about the fact that we are Zainin or Akunin, that is, you know, that we are incapable of any kind of positive activity, then how is it that we have Buddha nature? That's a major conflict. That's a paradox that has to be resolved. I think Shinran resolves it quite clearly, but you're not going to get that reading the material that's available to you right now. So, but let me just suggest a couple things. First of all, I think it requires us to think about these terms of, I know some of you don't know Japanese at all. Some of you generally translate it as sin. Okay. And it requires us to think about what words like tsumi and aku mean, okay? So if tsumi is sin and aku is, well, I don't know. Let's just say harm, okay? We use that instead of evil, okay? Then, people who are sinners, okay, right, or people who have done sin, something like that, then it requires us to think about what that means. And as I said to you before, this sort of reification, the simplification of the teachings about past karma being this weight, this destiny, this legacy that keeps us down, is really not about only about bad karma, it's about karma as a whole, okay? You should take Zen-aku as a comprehensive concept, not just bad, but good as well. In the same way, tsumi is something that everybody's involved in. That doesn't necessarily mean that you're a bad person or you're sinful or that you have original sin. So if you want to know what Buddha nature is, simply, it's the mere opposite of original sin. If you know what original sin is, you know how that works in Christianity. Original sin in Christianity comes from the interpretation of Adam and Eve in Genesis, right? Adam and Eve in Genesis, as you know, is an ancient story in the Old Testament, in the Hebrew Bible. Therefore, we would expect this to be a core doctrine of the Jewish faith, right? This was around for at least 1,000 years before Jesus was born. Is original sin a core doctrine of the Jewish faith? No, not at all. They don't have any such notion. What is this? This is a Christian interpretation of a Jewish story. It's a completely, it's a left turn, okay? They're going down a different road entirely. They're taking this story that comes out of this very ancient, right, almost primitive religion, which is mythically a very powerful story, right? But the Jews never interpret that as original sin. So what I say to you is be careful of a word like sin, because you're going to have associations with original sin, which is a kind of Christian notion. Now, original sin is very important in Christianity because it's part of the basic theology. It's because everyone is born in this original sin, which, by the way, from Thomas Aquinas, you inherit physically in your genes. In other words, if all of you are the product of sperm and egg, and I think you are, at this point anyway, the interpretation from like the 5th century in Europe was that therefore you have bloodline going all the way back to Adam and Eve, right? So Adam's sin is your sin. Okay, that's the interpretation. But the Jewish theology doesn't see it that way at all. That this is just a story about the fact that man separated himself from God. He ignored God at one point because he was pursuing something of personal meaning, right? And this created a kind of basic alienation. But not that everybody is tinged with that brush of sin, right? It's a very different interpretation. So you don't have to take the story of Adam and Eve to mean original sin at all, but nonetheless, it's in our culture in such a heavy way, right? So how do we think about sin in the Old Testament? How do we think about Sumi and Jubran? Well, these are very much contextually determined. If you look at biblical encyclopedias and dictionaries, you look up the word sin, you're going to see pages and pages of explanation. It means so many different things. It means bad things you do. It means bad situations you're in. It means, you know, things that you intentionally do, things that you do unintentionally, etc., etc. And this therefore pertains to what is the cause of bad karma for me as well. For example, in India, there's two basic ways to interpret karma, separate from the past, just in terms of what you do tonight or tomorrow. One way is that if you do anything that's harmful, that incurs bad karma. So in Jainism, that's their view. Therefore, Jain monks walk around with a brush, and they sweep the floor, they sweep the ground before they walk, so they don't step on any unseen bacteria, bugs, right? In other words, they don't want to kill anything, because that creates bad karma. That's morally unacceptable to them. For the Buddhists, Buddhists don't do that. Why is it the Jains do and the Buddhists don't do that? Because the Buddhists don't interpret karma that way. Well, what is a Buddhist interpretation of karma? In Buddhism, you don't incur bad karma unless you intend to do something bad. If intentionality is missing, you're not responsible. If you drive down the street and a cat runs in front of your car, and you hit the cat or the squirrel, it's terrible, it's a tragedy, but you're not karmically responsible because you didn't go out of your way to kill the cat. There must be intentionality involved. Yeah?
Is the flip side also true? You only incur good karma if you intend to do something good?
Absolutely. Okay. Something happens, someone comes along and gives you a Pete's coffee card to get some free coffee. You're lucky, but you don't get any good karma. So, you know, it's... Now, the other thing about that, that's a kind of basic Buddhist... No, that basic Buddhist idea is obviously comes to Japan through the scriptures, right? When we get to something like, and that, you know, the word sumi, for example, that's in the scriptures as well. It's in the Nirvana Sutra. But sumi is a word that is usually, I mean, in terms of Japanese usage and in Chinese usage, very much more contextually determined. That is, of course, you know, you do a bad deed. If you kill somebody, it's a bad deed in any context, unless there's some supposed good to become of it, but in general, that's incurred by karma. But sumi usually, you know, if you look at how it's used in ancient Japan, it has to do with breaking the rules of society. For example, I remember that one of the earliest definitions of sumi in Japan is the asemichi, which is a little sort of dirt boundaries between the rice paddies. If you break that, so the water flows from one to the other, you disturb the whole irrigation system, that's a tsumi. So anything that kind of violates the way society has organized itself is a tsumi. you go through a red light, you know, something like that. Now, is that bad karma? So what I'm saying is that sumi is very much socially, contextually determined. And it's not to say that a bad deed is not a sin also. You know, I have a friend who specifically works on translations of Vinaya material, that is, you know, monastic rules and things like this. And he insists, he says, Mark, don't ever translate these words as sin. He says, you create so much misunderstanding. He wants violation, you know, things like this. So I'm okay with that, you know, I have a hard time. So one of the big things about the Nirvana Sutra and Shinran is the story of Ajase, Ajatashatru, and most of you know about this. This occupies a big part of the citation or quotation of the Nirvana Sutra in the Shinjin chapter, or Shin chapter. And I'm actually translating that section right now. Okay, I've been working on this for the last 6 months. It occupies two whole fascicles of the Nirvana Sutra. It's a huge, long passage. Mm-hmm. Shinran just quotes a part of it. You know, you can be sure he knew the whole thing. And, this means a lot to him. Now, for those of you who don't know the story, Ajase's father was Bimbisara. He was one of the major supporters of Shakyamuni when he started the movement of Buddhism in India. And Ajase is the only son, and he kills his father. So he's not only guilty of the sin of what we call patricide, killing your father, which is worse than killing somebody else. Patricide and matricide are the two worst sins. And in India, if you look at the Contemplation Sutra, where Ajase at that point has put his father in prison, and his mother is sneaking food in to see the father, and then he gets so pissed off, he's now king because he's taken over by force, right? He pulls out his sword to kill his mother, and the ministers step in front of him and say, you can kill your father, but you can't kill your mother. And they say, you know, there have been lots of history of people killing their father, but not their mother, you know. If you do that, you know, we can't remain here. And interestingly, I came across that passage, and I noticed that the different versions of that sutra, in the last line, the conclusion, what the ministers saying to Ajase, different versions of that change, different versions of the sutra. That is a manuscript versus a printed text. So in one version, they say, we can no longer remain, we can't work for you anymore if you're going to kill your mother. In other words, we can stomach you killing your father, we'll still be loyal to you, but not if you kill your mother. But in the other version, that we part is taken out, and it just says, this cannot stand. In other words, it implies that you can't be king anymore, right? So someone took that out because they wanted to change this, you know, to put the onus on him. So the question is, which is older, right? Anyway, so, but in the Nirvana Sutra's version of Ajase, now this is many years later, he's now ill. He has a terrible skin disease, like pretty much like Job in the Old Testament, and he comes to Shakyamuni seeking relief. And that's because one of his ministers is this famous physician, Jivaka, who appears in many places in the Buddhist canon, a very wise man, who is both skilled as a doctor and also skilled in religious matters. And prior to him, there were six ministers who came to the king and said, your illness can't be cured by a normal physician, you have to go to a spiritual healer, who have special powers. And then they recommend different people, and these are the famous six so-called heretical teachers or non-Buddhist teachers in India. And after each presentation, Ajase says, I don't know if that works, but if they can really, you know, cure my illness, I'll be happy to go see them. I'll be their disciple for life, you know. So he's still holding back, okay. And then Jivaka comes along, and Jivaka says, all those people that said all that stuff, forget about it, you know. None of that's going to work. The only person who can really help you is Shakyamuni. And then he says, and here's why. And then he gives long, convincing monologue about this. But one of the powerful things in that story at that point is one of the things that Jivaka says is, the Buddha has repeatedly helped people who have sinned terribly, who have violated the rules, who have murdered people, who have killed their parents, you know. In other words, just like you, okay? This is what Shakyamuni can do, what the other people cannot do. So what we're talking about here goes back to what I was saying this morning, which is this conflict between karma and liberation, right? And this is a conflict, same issue we talked about earlier today, about, well, I have this legacy of my karma, is this destiny or not, right? And in the case, the reason that Shinran focuses on this story is not because Shinran identifies with Ajatasattu as someone who, Shinran did not kill his father, okay? Or his mother. We don't know that Shinran killed anybody, even got close to killing anybody. So this is why calling this stuff evil is kind of problematic for us. But Ajase himself refers to himself as this, okay? As a sinful person, okay? As a person who's violated the rules. But also he refers to himself as Aqua. He uses both terms in the Nirvana Sutta talking about his own situation. And he says, how could I possibly... So here's the normal karmic explanation of what happens when you kill your father or your mother is that you go to Avicii hell. You probably heard that term. Avicii hell is not just an Italian. It's not. It sounds like an Italian hell, right? There are many hells in Buddhism. Avicii is the lowest, right? All pasta, all day.
Seven servings.
Anyway. He has this terrible skin disease, and it smells bad. People can't even get close to him because it smells so bad. And he is aware of this, and he says, my hell rebirth, my hell future destiny has already started. I can see it here on my hands and my arms. You know? And so he says, at this point, it's too late. You know, how could anybody help me? And I'm slipping away. Okay. And so one of the issues is, Ajase has to believe, he has to have faith, okay, that he can be saved. If he doesn't, he's going to hell for sure. So this is a topic that's raised right there in the Nirvana Sutra in the midst of this discussion. You can see Shinran is really focused on this, right? And one of the statements in the Nirvana Sutra is, well, why don't you give him a better sense of confidence, and then he'll realize that that's not enough. Why are they saying that? Okay. In other words, everything is impermanent, even your faith, okay? You have to get to some deep, deep level whereby it is no longer an intellectual choice, right? So it's like I heard this October. In October, I went to Hiroshima to hear these Shin performance preachers called Fushinon Sekkyo. You guys probably have, you know, because I don't tell the same stories over and over. I don't think you've heard this story. So there was a... Fushinon Sekkyo is this really interesting kind of preaching, performancing that happens in Japan, only in Shin, and where people tell stories and sing and tell jokes. It's very much like stand-up comedy, except they're sitting, you know. And usually it's done in a temple. And usually they're, in the case of Nishi, you have to be a priest, you have to be ordained to do this. So it's kind of a preaching responsibility involved in this. On the Higashi side, you're not required to be ordained. But most people are. They come out in robes. And it's a very religious thing. You first face the Buddha, you know, and you kind of chant Nembutsu or do whatever you need to get your mind centered, and then the audience is behind you, right? Your back's to the audience. And then you turn around, and then you sit on this big kind of tatami dais in your robes, and then you start to talk. Yeah. Women do this as well. It's a really exciting kind of thing. I'm trying to bring them here to Berkeley. But it's all in very colloquial Japanese, so I don't know how we're going to pull off the language part of it. But anyway, I flew to Japan just to see this other performance. Because I've been four times now, and every time I go, my jaw drops. It's so wonderful. And I'm the only foreigner there, you know? And they all say, who's that guy? But this one guy, he comes out. And by the way, in Hiroshima, they did this in a public hall. It wasn't at a temple. Mm-hmm. It's the first time I'd seen it done not in a temple. And I really wanted to see what that would be like. And they had a Namame Butsu scroll on the stage. It's a public theater, you know. But it seemed to be fine. There was like 300 people there on a Tuesday afternoon at 3 o'clock. It was amazing how many people came. And I was just the same as being in a temple, so I thought, wow, yeah, we can do it here again. Anyway, so this one guy comes out, he's this skinny little guy with this long beard almost down to his waist. He's like this tall, he like weighs 75 pounds, and his beard weighs as much as he does. And he comes out, and he sits down, and people go, And he says, you're looking at me like I'm a funny looking guy, right? Everybody laughs, you know. But he had this great monologue, and one of the things that he talked about, they talked about like half of his talk, it was great, was this is in Japanese. He said, atama wo sageru, atama ga sagaru. What's the difference? So sageru, so one is a transitive verb, one is an intransitive verb. The transitive verb, atama wo sageru, is you put your head down, right? He's talking about bowing. He says, you know, he says, when you first hear it, they seem like they're the same thing. My head goes down, or I put my head down. What's the difference? The same thing, right? No, not the same thing. He says, what about, we just had an election. He said, what do the politicians do everywhere they go? They put their head down, and they say, vote for me, please, vote for me, okay? Onegai shimasu. They always put their head down. Whenever you ask somebody for something because you're going to gain, that's when you put your head down. Atama wo sageru, to drop your head, always means you want something for you. Okay? Said, that's a completely different situation. That's a kind of begging. You know, he says, that's a kind of supplication for a particular purpose. And you know when someone's doing that, they have a particular purpose in mind. It's very clear. Atama ga sagaru, when your head goes down by itself, he said, that's entirely different. That happens when something moves you and you don't make a decision. It just happens. Like you see the Buddha and you're knocked out. You see the image and the art is so powerful that your head goes, oh my God, you know. So it's something. And I, you know, you, like you think of the deer in Nara. If anyone's been to Nara, to Todaiji, the deer come up and they all was like this because they want a senbei, right? All these beautiful deer, yeah? Give me something to eat, you know? So I thought that was really, really nice, you know. And I think in a way, this is what the story in the Nirvana Sutra is about. Give him a sense of confidence that he can believe in this, and he will learn that that will disappear. That will be temporary, because that's not the real thing. That's still intellectual exercise. He's still deciding, I should believe because I'm sick, you know? I should believe because I don't want to go to hell. And as long as that's the situation, that's what the Buddha's saying, he's not, you know, he'll learn from that, got it, right? So, it's when Ajahn finally, you know, gets the Buddha's compassion, and the Buddha says right there, as long as Ajase is suffering, I will not enter Nirvana and leave this world. You know? That's the powerful moment, right? Shinran quotes that. That's a very famous line in Shinshu also, right? That the Buddha will postpone his own entry into Nirvana in order to help Ajase, right? I think that's where the Tannisho is coming from as well. So in that case, whether Ajase has done good things or bad things, or how bad his record is, or what his legacy is, or whether this is destiny or not, is completely beside the point. This is an existential question, right? What is the nature of existence? What is the nature of the Buddha? It's a relationship to my existence, right? And that's what they call Mahakarma, the great compassion is all about, is that the Buddha's compassion extends to every person, regardless, okay? That's when your head goes down, right? By itself, okay? So I think that's what we're trying to see, what Shinran is trying to communicate in the Tannisho here. And so that's why these words are powerful and in some sense vague. So maybe so let's go back and read 1 and 3 very quickly again so we can see the context. Volunteer. Go ahead. You got a text? You got another text. That's okay.
Saved by the inconceivable working of Amida's vow, I shall realize birth in the Pure Land. The moment you entrust yourself thus to the vow, so that the mind set upon saying the Nembutsu arises within you, you are immediately brought to share in the benefit of being grasped by Amida, never to be abandoned.
Yeah, one more.
Okay. Know that the primal vow of Amida makes no distinction between people young and old, good and evil. Only Shinjin is essential. For it is the vow to save the person whose karmic evil is deep and grave and whose blind passions abound.
Yeah, go ahead, finish it.
Okay. Thus, for those who entrust themselves to the primal vow, no good acts are required, because no good surpasses the Nembutsu. Nor need they despair of the evil they commit, for no evil can obstruct the working of Amida's primal vow.
Okay, so that principle, that no good surpasses the good of the Nembutsu, and elsewhere Shinran says the Nembutsu is therefore is not a good thing. Shinran says the Nembutsu is not good. And what he means by that is not good in the relative sense of good and bad, good and evil. The Nembutsu is of another dimension. And that's because of this whole, you might say, theological construct here, whereby the Nembutsu is an expression of that compassion idea. And that therefore it is not to be, there's no limitation to it, and therefore you can't call it good relative to some other good. And therefore you shouldn't call it good at all. That's how radical Shinran will be. Honen wouldn't go that far, but Shinran would go that far. So when you see things working in that sense, then you understand, I think this tells us therefore that Tsumi, or sin, or aku, bad, or harm, right, are also relative terms in that sense. They, as long as they operate within the relative construct of how good or bad one's karma is, then you can see that Nembutsu functions in a completely different way, symbolically speaking. Right? So let's now look at number three, which is, you know, what most people think about. The importance of one here is that the vow does not discriminate between young and old, good and evil. That's the point here, okay? So again, it's not. There's no condition for having access. So last time when I was talking about access, this is a key part of this whole construct. There are no conditions, except this kind of openness, right? I think that's why they translate Shinjin as entrusting. I mean, the words Shin and Jin don't mean entrusting, but that's the sense of what's happening, right? It's kind of letting go, right? And in some sense, you know. This pertains to Buddha nature as well, because one of the things that is happening, obviously, is that, how do you know you have Buddha nature? The sutra tells you? Well, that's nice. Sutra tells me there's a lot of angels up there also, you know, and my mother told me they liked me, you know, and my tooth fell out, and I got money from the tooth fairy, and a lot of nice things, you know. So I think the other thing that is misunderstood is that people think that Buddha nature is about Zen, and somehow faith is about Pure Land, you know. But in fact, Buddha nature is about everything, you know, in East Asian Buddhism. And it's always a matter of faith. It can't function in any other way because you can't see it. Until you can perceive it, you don't know that it's there, right? In some sense, it is a given in this whole structure, okay? This is why Shinran tells us that, in fact, Shinjin is about Buddha nature. They're both something that that require faith to sense, to feel, right? And that kind of faith can only have an intellectual component to some degree, but it can't be completely a kind of decision, right? Once it's a decision, then it's an intellectual process. Then it's the result of an intellectual process. That's atama osage, right? That's not the head goes down, that's you dropping your head because you want this thing. Has to somehow function in and of itself. And this is the way the Nirvana Sutra talks about Buddha nature, is that it becomes, it like manifests, it becomes perceivable. You know, you can look for it, you can look for it, but it's not something you can find by searching. You have to wait for it to appear. So in Zen, like in Dogen Zen, you sit and you face the ball and you just wait. Could take a week, could take a decade, you know. It could take a lifetime, but eventually, boom, you know, it comes up because it's inside you. You know, that means that Dogen can promote that teaching only on the basis of faith. He has to have faith that this is real. He can do that because he has experienced it, right? Hopefully, you always want a teacher that has experienced what they're talking about, right? That makes it easier for you to accept, again, on faith that there's some basis in this, right? So, anyway. So that's one. So let's look at three. Okay, three obviously is. So who wants to read three? Okay.
Even a good person.
Excuse me. Every reading is a different translation. Isn't this wonderful?
Even a good person is born in the Pure Land. How much more so is an evil person? However, people in the world usually say, even an evil person is born in the Pure Land. How much more so is a good person? At first sight, this view seems to be reasonable, but it is contrary to the purport of the original vow of the other power. The reason is that as those who practice good by their self-power, sorry, this is really not normal English.
Having trouble with the translation? So slow down.
Okay.
In other words, I think read it with the expectation that it's not going to be normal English.
Okay. The reason is that, as those who practice good by their self-power lack the mind to rely wholly on the other power, they are not in accordance with the original vow of Amida. However, if they convert their minds of self-power and trust to trust the other power, their birth in the true land of recompense is assured. Amida made his vow out of compassion for us who are full of evil passions and who are able to set ourselves free from samsara by any practice. Since the purpose of his vow is to have evil persons attain Buddhahood, the evil person who trusts the other power is especially the one who has the right cause for birth in the Pure Land. Hence the words, even a good person is born in the Pure Land, how much more so is an evil person? Thus the Master said.
Okay. Now, this thing, chapter 3 that you just read, is perceived to be the reason why the Tannisho was supposedly not shown outside the Shin community until the 20th century.
Mm-hmm.
Because this seems to be a very kind of dangerous doctrine. So, in religious studies we call this the danger of antinomianism. Antinomianism means that you can do evil without any accountability, okay? Or even that you do evil because you think it'll help, okay? So, and this was a problem among not only Shinran's followers, but Honen's followers in general.
Mm-hmm.
So there was various historical things that happened. You know, I've spoken here before about this. One thing about the historical documents that we have is Shinran is never mentioned anywhere. There's no historical footprint of Shinran in Kyoto. His following was so tiny. His name appears among the list of Honen's disciples. That's about it. But Honen has such a huge impact. His name is all over the place. So Honen and Honen's followers and all the problems that happen associated with him. There's lots of evidence about this. And one of the things that happened is that there were people complained about Honen's success. And the people who complained about it said, look, you're encouraging people to do whatever they want and not to live by the rules of society because you tell them that the Buddha will accept them regardless. Okay, precisely what Shinran is talking about here. And so Honen therefore wrote this one-page document, okay, in which he says, no one is encouraged to do anything bad. The Buddha's compassion is absolute, but that doesn't give license to what's called license to evil, right? To do behavior. So the problem is that if you pull back from this kind of universality too much, then the religious power of the message weakens a bit. So chapter 3 here seems to be a way to clearly state the strong side of the Honen doctrine, which is that the Buddha does not make his vow of compassion for people who are good.
Mm-hmm.
He makes it for people who are bad. And why does he do that? Because people who are good don't need it.
Mm-hmm.
Remember, the tradition is that you can become a Buddha by your own efforts, right? And Honen is saying, when Honen says, I become a disciple of Amitabha Buddha, Honen is saying, in effect, I announce publicly, I can't become a Buddha.
Okay.
It's an existential statement about himself. And then he says, if anyone else feels they can't become a Buddha, I suggest you follow me. Okay? And suddenly everyone's following him, you know. So there's something, again, very powerful in that message. But to really clarify that, you have to say the Buddha is really interested in people who are really in trouble. And this same discussion, the same way of framing this problem, is in the Nirvana Sutra discussion about Ajase again. So, in other words, Jivaka says to Ajase, the Buddha is not here for people who don't need him. Buddha is here for people who need him. And you are precisely the person who needs him, you know? And that's why this story becomes so monumental, because it has great symbolic significance, right? The Buddha's promise to help people in need, not only being extensive, but specifically being about people like Ajase who've done the worst possible thing. And interesting also in that Nirvana Sutra discussion, Ajahn says very clearly, my father who was innocent, who was a good religious man, who did the right thing, I murdered him for my own ambition. Okay? Clearly, I have no right to ask the Buddha for anything. You know, I deserve to go to heaven. Okay? But then something else happens. Okay? Then the Buddha presents a story about Bimbisara murdering a monk in the mountains. Right? You guys know this too? Yeah. Suddenly we have this other thing that happens where, by the way, you're a great saintly father, went hunting one day, and there was a monk, a sadhu, a kind of holy man, living up in the Himalayas, and he saw that the party was coming to hunt deer, and he told all the deer, he helped the deer escape. He went out, because he had special powers himself, communicated to them, you better run away because the king will come to kill you. And all the deer ran away, and so they got up there to hunt. There was nothing to hunt. There were no animals. And the king said, what happened? Every time we come here, we have a good hunt. And there's nothing to hunt. And so his advisor said, it's that guy, you know? And in his anger, he killed him, okay? Couldn't kill the deer, so he killed the holy man. So, in other words, what that does what? That takes the idealized king, supporter of the Buddha more than any other king in India, and now we relativize his goodness, just like we've relativized Ajahn's badness. Right? That's what the Nirvana Sutra is doing. Why is the Nirvana Sutra doing that? Again, to show that nobody is purely good and nobody is purely bad. There is Buddhas and there are sattvas, sentient beings or living beings. And if you're a Buddha, karma doesn't pertain to you. But if you're everybody else, you know, you have a mixed karmic record. Everybody has a mixed karmic record. If they didn't, they would be a Buddha, right? So, this statement about the Buddha extending, you know, his compassion to bad people is really a statement about the Buddha extending his compassion to the world. So it's not about being evil. That's why I don't like the word evil, because we're not evil. We're just simply people who are not Buddhas. So to me, that's what the Aquanian term, Aquanian or Zionian, that's what these words mean. People who are not Buddhist, okay? That's really all it is. Yeah.
So quick question. So you talk, it's interesting because you talk a lot about the misinterpretations or the misuse of the word evil in today's context, especially attributed to this document. However, I'm not assuming you're doing this, but are you giving benefit of the doubt to the people who heard this document, that they listened to this document and understood it the correct way it was supposed to be understood?
Are you talking about you, Ian? You're talking about today in the 20th century?
No, I'm talking about, like, yeah, when this document was read in the time that it was written or something, or like if Aku was explained to the people or to
I don't
the
think
masses.
It needed to be explained.
Okay.
My view is that at the time that Honen and Shinran are writing, people had a view of Aku very much like I'm explaining. You know, I'm speaking, maybe I'm overconfident, but I believe I have some sense of how they use the term.
Okay.
And I say that because I've seen the term used in a wide array of contexts. Okay. So, for example, like Varoshi and Ashi are two different classical Japanese readings of the same kanji. And they have different implications, you know. Mm-hmm. Varoshi and Ashi have different degrees of badness, okay? Mm-hmm. This shows that there were two different words in Japanese, mm-hmm. and there were Japanese words long before Chinese came in, okay? And then they said, okay, like ateji, you know what ateji is? Ateji are Chinese characters that are applied to pre-existing Japanese words, okay? Since anytime a Chinese character represents a Japanese word in traditional language writing, that's what's happening, you know? So we have a Chinese word that comes in as a Chinese, like aku, that's a Chinese word, okay? Mm-hmm. But warosi and ashi are Japanese words, and so it turns out they use the same kanji to represent both of them, which means already that, and warosi and ashi are not the same thing. So this tells us already that aku has a pretty wide range of meaning. Mm-hmm. So my view is that, I don't know the exact relationship between the scriptural use of a word like aku or a word like tsumi, okay? And the contemporary Japanese, which is in the 13th century, that's hard to determine. That's really beyond my pay grade. I would love to be able to do that. You know, that would be a great dissertation, actually. But that's a very complicated topic. But I've been thinking about this for a long time, and I've been, you know, looking at this problem, and it's pretty clear that at least in the case of Shinran, he's using the term in a way that I'm thinking that the people that he's talking to also are familiar with this.
Okay.
In terms of how it's used in the Nirvana Sutra, how it's used in the Pure Land Sutras, and how it's used in Japanese society as a whole.
Mm-hmm.
So it would be very strange for me to believe that Shinran isn't aware of the way we see it being used in popular literature of the time, for example.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? Poetry, for example,
mm-hmm.
things like that. And if you see it in those contexts, you see this very broad range of usage that I'm using here. Tsumi is the same. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Now, and how that problem relates to translations, that's another matter entirely.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, what motivates the translators in the collective works of Shinran, or Uno Sensei, or all the translations we have, the degree to which they're thinking about it as I'm thinking about it, I don't know. My guess is not too much. My guess is they're trying to present a kind of clear, articulate message.
Mm-hmm.
And at some point, someone decided this should be evil, and so we always see evil.
Mm-hmm.
And so what I'm saying is, if you understand that evil pertains to this wide range of meaning, you're okay. But if you don't, if you're not thinking in those terms, you're going to really get the wrong idea here. I mean, I'll tell you something else. One of the reasons that I'm doing this Tannisho project is because I've been teaching Pure Land Buddhism in the university for quite a long time, and every time we read the Tannisho, the students always say, "What kind of a text is this? Why would anybody be interested in this religion? I'm not evil." Do you expect me to come to the temple and then you're going to tell me I'm evil? And then somehow I'm going to get saved by this garbage? Forget it. You know? Students don't like it. Okay? And they say, is that really what's happening? And the Japanese people all think they're evil? You know?
Mm-hmm.
And then I have to say, no, they're not evil. You know? And so, so I realize this is kind of an issue, you know? And, you know, evil in the Western context also used to mean something else.
Right, yeah.
So, but today, you know, because it's limited to a very narrow, very extremely bad, you know, kind of label on something. You know, if you look at like these early writings on theodicy in the West, Leibniz and stuff, evil people include victims, you know.
Mm.
But we don't use it that way today. I think for Shinran, evil Akunin includes victimization. In other words, I think he considers himself an Akunin or a Zionin,
mm.
but I think that includes a sense of being victimized, okay?
Mm.
In other words, circumstance, like I said earlier today, is part of this whole discussion.
Right.
Like, we're all in difficult circumstances, and in that sense, we are troubled, okay?
Right.
So one way I translate Aku is troubled, okay? Troubled, you know, as a passive participle. A troubled person, okay? Or as I just said before, anyone who's not a Buddha is in some sense troubled. So, question?
Okay.
Yeah.
I apologize. I wasn't in the last session. I was on last.
Sure.
When you use the word harm, because I'm really interested in the Akunin, and I'm glad that you're here today
Okay. Teaching
us about it.
Thanks.
Does harm then indicate that it's harm that is like I'm harming someone out there, or I'm causing self-harm because I'm bringing my karma, or is it like everything?
It's everything. It also means the potential for harm. That's why aku also means dangerous. Okay, so this is very clear to me in the how the Nirvana Sutra uses often to refer to elephants. It's a very common adjective for elephants. When an elephant is in heat or in rut, okay, they're called aku, and that's because they can't be controlled.
Wow.
So you know, in terms of Indian society, the elephant was the most dangerous animal. I mean. Of course, lions and tigers can come in and eat you alive as well. But elephants, because they were domesticated most of the time,
mm-hmm.
people thought they had control over them. But when an elephant gets pissed off, you can't hold him back.
Mm-hmm.
Not in those days. So what's an akuzo, you know?
Right.
Another use of aku that's very common is in terms of the three bad states of rebirth.
Mm-hmm.
The hungry ghosts, hells,
mm-hmm.
And animals, okay? That's the typical standard language in the Buddhist, Chinese Buddhist canon. It's called them aku do, do being, or shu, meaning sort of stage of rebirth realm or something, okay? That means that animals are all evil. What the hell is that all about? When did animals become evil, you know? So it's not just a dangerous elephant because he's out of control for some reason, but it means all the entire animal kingdom is evil? That's not what it means. Clearly, that's not what's happening here. In this sense, harm is the sense that they've been harmed, okay? If you look about, from the karmic standpoint, being reborn as an animal means you've essentially been victimized by your own karma, right? It's karmic retribution, but You look at the dog, you look at the cat, you look at the limitations of what they can do, you realize they're not doing anything wrong, they're just limited. They're essentially, they've been harmed. Okay, they're victims in that sense too. So, I mean, that's why it's a very, very broad term, and you have to be very, very careful. You know, we don't have to translate a word like that the same way every time. You know, I think just like today, we have this term akuyu. If you know Japanese, akuyu means a bad friend. Okay, this is actually in the Nirvana Sutra. That's where it comes from. An akuyu is a term that a contemporary Japanese people use. Kobayashi-san, what's an akuyu?
Akuyu, good friend.
Good friend. So why is it called aku then?
I think classical literary speaking, akuyu means a kind of, you know, inviting you to something, especially bad thing. That is the original meaning of akuyu, bad kind of evil friend. But today, akuyu is more contemporary Japanese usage. Akuyu means like a good friend, like a go drinking together, or do something, you know, not escalate bad, something bad together. So that's kind of akuyu. Like, yeah. That's why
just the same way that bad is like, you know, like at one point in subculture, I mean American subculture, meant like cool.
Yeah, just like an akuyu is actually a very intimate friend. I think that's the best way to translate it. Someone who's close to you that you can afford to do bad things with, like get drunk, you know?
Yeah.
Go off
on.
What's that?
Partnering crime.
Yeah. I think if women spend the whole day shopping, that would be me akuyu thing to do. My wife wouldn't like to hear that, but in any case, you know what I'm talking about? So the Japanese use akuyu in a very, you know, weak way in that sense. And I don't think it's discontinuous with this at all. So in some sense, it's a kind of recognition of the fact that everybody is aku in a way. But we can't be aku with everybody. It has to be people you trust, right?
Yeah.
Right. In other words, you're allowed to expose your weak side, something like that, right? Indulge in things, something like that. Anyway, all right, so let's oh, it's 2 o'clock.
What the?
Are we done?
You have
2:30. Oh,
2:30?
Yeah. Okay, so let's now read 14, okay? So who hasn't read yet?
Okay. Cool.
So what do you read?
Another version, but
another version. Cool.
Yeah, okay, that's right. Oh. Anybody know this book?
I have one of those somewhere.
You stole it.
Not Akunin. Aku you.
Hey, that's okay. Chapter 14. Concerning the assertion, you should believe that the grave karmic evil binding you to 8 billion kalpas of birth and death is eradicated through a single utterance of the name.
All right, stop. So let's hold on for a second. What is that, right? Wow. So this is what's called metsuzai in Japanese. This refers to eliminating bad karmic information on the basis of some ritual action. Mm-hmm. This is a big part of Buddhism, is a kind of miraculous part of Buddhism that the people who think of Buddhism as a radical philosophy don't like to talk about, but actually it's all throughout the scriptures, okay? Mm-hmm. Why? It's in the scriptures because, again, people had anxiety about their karmic status. Mm-hmm. And that's why I think this part of the aku zaini problem is that everybody doesn't know what their karmic status is, particularly since it includes past lives. Mm-hmm. You can't possibly know. And that's, for us, you know, an additional problem is the notions of moral good and bad today have changed so much in the last 150 years, right? The behavior that we think is okay wasn't okay 30 years ago, you know what I'm saying? So what the hell's the world's gonna be like 20 years from now? So again, the Buddhist scriptures understand that. And that's another reason why this is always relativized. You know, you can't know, except for these 5 terrible crimes, right? Matricide, patricide, you know, disrupting the Sangha, causing a Buddha to bleed, you know, attacking a Buddha. These 5 heinous crimes. Other than that, there's not a lot of specificity about what's considered bad behavior, because it changes. All right, sorry. So anyway, Nembutsu, what this is about is the idea that you do the Nembutsu one time properly and that can wipe out all your bad karma. So before you go on, just to give a little more background, this again is another example of why I think Mappo is different in the Kamigoto period than the Heian period. So in the Heian period, And this continues in this time as well, but it's slowly, it's already dying out. And I think, again, this is one of the legacies of Honen, is the belief that how you die will affect your rebirth. In other words, there was a belief, this goes back to India, that how you behave in the final moments of your life, right before you die, has greater impact than what you did before that time. Mm. That this is a special kind of heightened, powerful moment. So the way it worked in Han period was that you would recite the Lotus Sutra, and then that would get rid of your, ritually, that supposedly would get rid of your bad karma, and then you would chant Nembutsu, so you can face, Amitabha will respond to you when you die. At the moment you actually pass out and die, the Buddha will be there. But you have to get rid of your bad karma first, otherwise the Buddha won't be happy. So people in the beginning, early Han period, middle Han period, are chanting the Lotus Sutra for that purpose. And then Honen comes along and says, you don't need to chant the Lotus Sutra. The Nembutsu will do that for you. So that's part of the Honen doctrine, is don't worry about it. The Nembutsu has enough power to do that as well. Mm-hmm. But nonetheless, what Honen really wants to teach, and what Shinran wants to teach here as well, is that that's not what this is all about. In other words, if we're still thinking in terms of, I got to remove my bad karma or I can't get to the Pure Land, then we're always going to have some anxiety about having some karmic restriction that prevents us from succeeding at this, right? And that's very, very different. So that's what he's responding to. But this goes back to, again, evil people, right? And evil people needing some kind of special needs. Okay, go ahead. This statement
is based on the sutra passage describing a person with the 10 transgressions and 5 damning acts who has passed his life without saying the name. At the very brink of death, moved by the instruction of the true teacher, he comes to utter it for the first time.
So saying the name refers to recitation of Nembutsu, right? Yeah.
Saying it once, he eradicates 8 billion kalpas of karmic evil. Mm-hmm. Or saying it 10 times, he eradicates 10 times 8 billion kalpas of great karmic
evil. Is that enough? 10 times 8 billion kalpas?
Yeah, that erased us. That wiped the wild heart, yes.
Yeah, that wipes the heart. Okay.
Here, in order to make us realize the gravity of the 10 transgressions and the 5 damning acts, 1 utterance and 10 utterances are mentioned, indicating the Nembutsu's benefit of eradicating evil. Such Nembutsu practice, however, falls far short of that in which we have entrusted ourselves. Continue?
Yeah, so this next part is really key, I think. We believe.
Yeah. We believe.
Now, by the way, we believe is not Shinran.
Yeah.
Shinran doesn't say we believe. Shinran always says I believe. Okay. Yeah. This is Yuyan. He's talking about our community. Okay. This is how we understand things.
We believe that by virtue of being shown upon by Amida's light, at the moment the thought instant of entrusting first awakens within us, we receive diamond-like Shinjin. So that already in that instant, Amida takes us into the stage of the truly settled, and when our lives end, all our blind passions and obstructing evils are transformed, and we are brought to the realization of insight into the non-ordination of all existence. Thus, a lifetime of saying the Nembutsu with the thought, if it were not for this compassionate vow, how could such wretched evildoers as ourselves gain emancipation from birth and death, is to be recognized as entirely an expression of gratitude for the benevolence of Amida's great compassion, of thankfulness for the Buddha's virtuous working.
Wow. Boy, these transitions are really different. Here, instead of saying we believe, we have to believe, okay? Mm-hmm. We have no subject, right? Mm-hmm. I don't have the Japanese money, but I'm sure there is no subject, right? It's probably the same. So that's tricky. You have to decide who's speaking, right? Anyway, okay, so any questions about this? The key switch, the key kind of newness here, and this, again, is same in Honen as it is here, is that it is not the moment of death. It is not what's called the Rinju in Japanese. Rinju Shonen is a term. To have Shonen is proper Tarashi Nen, state of mind, at Rinju, the last moment of your life. This is something that, at that time people are preparing for, you know. So you do a lot of practice. In fact, a typical thing that happens is when you die, you had a lot of people in the room chanting Nenbutsu with you, because you go in and out of consciousness and you don't know when you're going to fall off. And so when you, if you drifted away and then you start to drift back, the Nenbutsu will be around you. It'll be easy for you to get back into it. Like, what am I doing? Oh yeah, I'm chanting Nenbutsu. Oh yeah, I'm dying here, you know. So that focus on that moment, and everyone's there to help you, right? That shift, there's a shift happening from that moment to another really, really crucial moment, which is a moment of awakening, okay? And so that's described here as the thought moment of entrusting first awakens within us, okay? Mm-hmm. So in other words, Shinjin as a momentary awakening, something like that. Mm-hmm. Now, I like this also because it tells us very clearly that Shinjin is not an intellectual conclusion. It's an awakening, right? Again, it's Atama Gassagaru, it's the head coming down by itself. It's something that you don't choose to do. It's something that grabs you by the back of the neck, right? Oh my God. You know, I tell you, if you guys, I've been very lucky because I get to go to Japan a lot, and I've seen a lot of beautiful Buddhist art. And there's some Buddhist statues that are like objects of great cultic significance. This happens not just in Buddhism. You know, I would tell the story. I was in Bogota with my wife, who's this very strong Catholic, and we went into this big church, okay? She goes to church every Sunday, come hell or high water. And she doesn't care what the priest says, she wants to be there for the Mass. She just likes the ritual part of it, right? Mm-hmm. And so we were always going to these interesting churches and all these interesting places, and we went to this church in Bogota, and it was huge, okay? Hundreds and hundreds of thousands of people in there. And there were images all along the, you know, there's the image in the altar, and then there are images all along the wall, either wall as well. There must have been 7 or 8 images on each side, okay, of the building, and then, of course, the image in the altar. And as we walk into this building, there's one image in which, in front of which, not none of the other images have this. There's, of course, flowers and things on the main altar, but this one image, there's thousands of flowers, okay? And there's a woman standing in front of it weeping. And my mouth was open, I just couldn't believe it, you know? And so, so powerful. And then everybody, as they walked by, they all stopped and bowed and prayed to that image. And they didn't do that to any of the other images. What's going on, you know? That's the image that works, you know? Yeah. For whatever reason, I can't see it, you know? I don't even know if my wife can see it, but somebody could see it, okay? And that gets passed on, you know, again and again and again. And so, same thing about Buddha's imagery. You see a lot of Buddha's paintings and statues, and some just knock you out.
Yeah.
And so, right? And some are powerful cult objects, you know? And in Japan, they have secret images, hibutsu, that are hidden. Mm. And the idea here is that this is so powerful, we got to protect it. You know? We'll just show it once a year or once a decade or something like that, you know, and then when they do, everybody comes. So, and then there are images that are never shown, you know, like Zenkoji, this amazing temple in central Japan in Nagano where it's always hidden. Right? Although we know Hideyoshi commanded that that be sent to Kyoto to be copied, you know. So we have copies of it, so I know what it looks like, but you can't see the real one. So he thought he could make a copy of it and this would work, and it caused all sorts of trouble, and he said, okay, I give up on this thing. So, you know, it's, again, it's this kind of not intentional, but unintentional response to these symbols. Mm-hmm. Okay, all right, so let's keep going.
Oh, okay. To believe that each time you say the name, your karmic evil is eradicated, is nothing but to strive to obtain birth by eliminating your karmic evil yourself. In that case, you can attain birth only by maintaining diligent by remaining diligent in the negative to the very point of death. For every thought a person has throughout the course of his life forms one more fetter binding him to birth and death. But since there is a limit to the karmic recompense by which our present life is maintained, we may meet with a variety of totally unforeseen accidents, or, tormented by sickness, reach the end of our lives without abiding in right-mindedness. In such circumstances, saying the name is difficult. How then is the karmic evil committed in that final interval to be eliminated? And if it is not eliminated, is not birth unattainable?
So he's talking about, again, the final, the death moment.
Mm-hmm.
So it's this, the word for this is, reach the end of our lives without abiding in right-mindedness. That right-mindedness is, I'm sure, this.
Okay.
Correct, proper, right, nim. Okay. So the nim nimbutsu also means your state of mind. Okay. What you're thinking, right? The thought, the proper thought. That's the right-mindedness. What if we get to there, we can't do it? So one of the problems with this whole religious paradigm is when you're dying, you're not in good shape. You know, most people are really sick. And they're hurting. They're in, you know, they have physical pain, mental pain. Something's not working. You know, their kidneys have failed. Who knows what? It's such a horrible place to be to demand someone to have the absolute proper state of mind. You know, it was a real struggle. You know, it's a really difficult thing. And so Honen is saying, forget about it. It's just a stupid thing. So Honen has this sermon called the Gyakshu Seppo. Gyakshu means turned upside down. Okay, and the Gyakshu Seppo is a plea to his audience to prepare for death now while you're healthy, not at the end, okay? And that means turn to Nembutsu, right? And engage in Nembutsu practice and see what it can do for you. In other words, get to this kind of state of Shinji now, right? Don't wait to the end, right? And if you do that, you take care of the whole thing long ahead of time. And therefore, death is no longer such a stressful. Death is bad enough, not having to add this as a god, right? Okay, almost done.
Two more paragraphs.
All right, go ahead.
If we entrust ourselves to Amida's vow to grasp and never abandon us, then even though through unforeseen circumstances we commit an evil act at the very end and die without the nimbutsu emerging on our lips, we will immediately realize birth into the pure land. Moreover, even if we do spontaneously say the nimbutsu at the point of death, it is nothing other than our expression of gratitude for Amida's benevolence and trusting to the Buddha more and more as the time of enlightenment draws near.
So, two things I want to say here. One, it pertains back to Buddha nature again, and second is this blind passions, you know, this kind of language. This is also not good. So, no offense. If you like that term, go ahead, don't ask me to use it. So, wise blind passions, not a good translation, because this is, the word here is klesha. Klesha refers to any and all mental aberrations. Okay? This is the kind of core structure of the Buddhist path. Is that we have these mental aberrations, defilements is a better word. Our thinking is defiled. It's defiled by our desires and our anxieties. It's not about blind, and it's not about passion. Nothing to do with that. It's blind in the sense that most of us are unaware of a lot of it. Some of it we can realize, some of it we can't realize, because it happens on almost an unconscious level. The purpose of meditation is to clarify these things.
Mm.
So, bonno is a Japanese term for this, and so blind passions implies that somehow passion, other passion is good, but blind passion is bad, I guess, I don't know. Anyway, it's nothing to do with passion, okay? Desire is part of it, right? You know, unchecked desire, etc., etc., but it's really about this kind of aberrative or defiled thinking in which we manipulate our perceptions to serve our own emotional needs.
Mm.
That's what this is about. And that's why when the text speaks of that, what happens if we've done everything right and then at the end of our life we do a bad thing again, you know what I'm saying? Does that mean we can't get to the Pure Land? And so that's still within the realm of calculation of good versus evil. How much good do I have versus how much bad karma do I have, et cetera, et cetera. And that's trying to be rejected. Right? But that's not what this is about. Yeah, and the other point is about, you know, we say the nimbutsu and gratitude. Saying the nimbutsu and gratitude, I think, works on two levels. On the one hand, gratitude is a great thing to feel. And in Japanese culture, particularly demanded, okay? You should feel gratitude all the time. Toward your parents, you know, toward the farmers that grow the food for you, toward the Buddha, toward your local Shinshu priest, all of you included, et cetera, et cetera. Gratitude is about something else also. It's also about the fact that we're not using the nimbutsu in a calculated fashion. In other words, we're not using it because it has some instrumentality to it. So one of the things about the Tannisho, it's in an earlier section we're not reading when Shinran's actually speaking, he rejects the instrumentality of the nimbutsu. Nimbutsu is not used for any purpose whatsoever. And that's because it's not good. The nimbutsu is not good. It is meaningless if you put it into those terms, okay? It doesn't function in that way. In the same way, you can't talk about the Buddha as being relatively good or better. This God is better than that God. That's one of the shifts from the Old Testament to the New Testament. In the Old Testament, God is a jealous God, right? Baal is his rival, you know? People were supporting Baal, they have a debate, and Baal loses, and God smokes them, you know? He gets rid of them, so he kills them all. So clearly you can see there's kind of military dimension to this. And then when you get to the New Testament, it's like, oh, okay, we're beyond that now, you know? God doesn't need to compete with other gods anymore. He's established himself as the supreme thing. And so this is what we're trying to see over and over again in the Tannisho about nimbutsu not being having any instrumental purpose. So I don't think that gratitude is really such a strong requirement here. If you feel gratitude, that's fine. But I think it's more about recognizing that nimbutsu is not something to be used for some other purpose. But the nimbutsu is an expression of the Buddha himself, of the Buddha's compassion, the Buddha's vows, all the things that you might say the Buddha's dynamic involvement in the world of sentient beings, of us, right? And therefore, you say the nimbutsu almost in recognition of this fact that it's universal, that it's regardless, you know, of anyone's circumstance, something like that. And if that's expressed as gratitude, that's fine. But I don't think that's really has to be the main way you think about it. Okay. Questions? I guess I must have questions. I've been talking so much. Someone else talk.
Well, there is one more paragraph.
Okay. Go for it.
Right. And I'll just say in advance, this paragraph from my personal opinion basically summarizes the issue that's discussed here in this chapter.
Okay.
The impulse to eradicate one's karmic evil through saying the name arises from the heart of self-power. It is the basic aim of people who pray to be in a state of right-mindedness when their lives end. It therefore reveals an absence of Shinjin that is other power.
So that's a very kind of polemic statement. So that really needs... I mean, you can just take it as straightforward, but why do you need to be concerned about this kind of thing? Mm-hmm. And so maybe I can add a little bit of context to that. Mm-hmm. So this language of self-power nimbutsu versus other power nimbutsu, this is really begins in Shinran's generation. If you look at the writings of Honen, you look at the writings of Honen students talk about this pretty often. Honen almost never talks about it. There's only two places I know in Honen's writings where this language comes up, and my Jodo Shu scholar friends and I concur that this means that these works are not by Honen. Okay? In other words, it's so characteristic of the next generation's concerns, okay, of the debates happening, that Honen doesn't seem to be engaged in that at all. It's really kind of an invention of sort of first half of 13th century rhetoric. Honen dies in 1212. And so what is this about and why are they so concerned about it? So, and here's what I think is going on. Honen seems to, again, you know, you could analyze Honen's writings as being completely un-new. In other words, almost everything Honen says has been said before. Actually, when I gave my job talk at Berkeley, that's what I said. I said, you know, give a talk about your research. I give my research on my conclusions. Nothing in Honen is new. He said, well, what do you want to say? And I said, I got nothing to say. You know, all I can say is it's not here. There's no there. You know, whatever. I looked at all these writings prior to Honen in the hand period, and they're all saying the same thing. Yeah. So, but what Honen seems to add is, again, this kind of coherent, articulate statement of Nembutsu as functioning on its own, right? Mm-hmm. And that we have access. Again, I think that's what it's about. Mm-hmm. So, however, because Nembutsu has been around for a very long time, and because Nembutsu, remember, begins not as a practice by lay people, but a practice by monks and nuns, right? Therefore, it's part of the traditional toolbox of the professional monastic, okay? Who does meditation, who does sutra chanting, who does ritual activities, and who does Nembutsu, okay? And so, for that purpose, Nembutsu, in that traditional context, is one of the many things you do in order to advance yourself, to produce merit, to produce good karma, to reduce your bad karma, and to advance your spiritual understanding, to weaken your defilements, your bone marrow, right? As you progress closer and closer on the path to nirvana. That's what they mean by self-power in Nembutsu. In other words, that's a kind of instrumental view of Nembutsu. The real problem is not that Nembutsu doesn't do all those things. The real problem is it puts Nembutsu in the same genre, in the same category as all other forms of practice. And here's where Honen said no. Here's where Honen said something that probably had not been said before, which is that the Nembutsu is not the same as other practices. The Nembutsu is unique. The Nembutsu is not like anything else, because the Nembutsu is, in my understanding, the manifest presence of the Buddha in our own lives. In other words, the Nembutsu is like an image of the Buddha. It's a manifestation of the Buddha on our own lips, right? Okay. It empowers us to evoke the Buddha. None of the practices have that power. You might say it's a kind of a ritual empowerment of the symbol, in a way, for Honen, that no other symbols could possibly have. And he has an elaborate, you know, doctrinal explanation to justify this interpretation. Shinran completely gets that, okay? So for Shinran, the Nembutsu functions has that power exactly as Honen describes it. And for Shinran, this is what transforms him, you know, when he suddenly realizes that by touching it, he's been transformed. So that's the kind of thing that that other power Nembutsu means, okay? So other power Nembutsu doesn't necessarily, it's not a different Nembutsu, it's a different recognition, a different aspect of it, okay? It's the same Nembutsu, it's the same name, it's the same Buddha, but it's a way of is tapping into, you might say, the kind of hidden dimension behind the chair. So here's me, then there's something else back here. I don't know what it is, but I guarantee you it's really cool. If you could but see it, you would see how cool it is, okay? But you can't get to it directly, right? It's a kind of intuitive thing, right? Just like Buddha nature functions the same way. It's there, but you can't quite see it. You can feel it. You can feel it working, something like that. Mm-hmm. This is the working of Nembutsu, the working of Buddha nature, is sort of bubbling up inside you. So another way to think about Buddha nature and Nembutsu in this context is if you think that the Buddha nature inside you is active, and the Nirvana Sutra, this is an unclear point. Is it actually actively doing stuff, or is it just sitting there? It's not clear. I'm always looking for clarification on this. But in a way, you know, the Nembutsu is a kind of manifestation of the Buddha. Therefore, the Nembutsu is a manifestation of Buddha nature. Therefore, the Nembutsu is a manifestation of your own Buddha nature, of the fact that the Buddha nature in you is no different than the Buddha nature in Amitabha. If you want Amitabha to be this transcendent figure up in the sky, then don't listen to me. But if you're okay with this, and I think this is where Shinran is coming from, he's saying Buddha nature is me, but Buddha nature is the Buddha itself. What's different about Amitabha and myself is that he has manifested fully, okay? Mm-hmm. And I have not, okay? But I am a Buddha in some sense, even though I'm not really fully a Buddha, right? That kind of, it's a paradox, but I think that's where Shinran is coming from. And what is the nature of that relationship between what I could be and what I am? That's Nembutsu.
Okay.
So that's one way the Shinran is. That's the other power, Nembutsu. The other power is the power of the Buddha. The Buddha that I can't, the Buddha nature that I can't see, that I have somehow, somewhere, that's somehow functioning. I don't know what it is, but I feel it, you know. It's an intuitive kind of gut reaction, right, that kind of takes me, that puts my head down, right? That kind of thing. So I think that's what's going on here. So the reason that this self-power, other-power debate is happening is because the Pure Land people are trying to distinguish themselves as advancing a new notion of Nembutsu that's different than what had been practiced before, and which is a very large practice. In other words, they're not inventing Nembutsu. It's all over Buddhism. But they're trying to say, we have a different view, but we're talking about this other thing, this Buddha nature Nembutsu. This is another thing entirely. And if you look at the writings, as I have, of the all these disciples of, in fact, Dogen uses the term other power, self-power too. Self-power, and Nichiren uses it also. It's not just Pure Land. Self-power and other power in the Kamakura period mean good and bad. If it's self-power, it's bad. If it's other power, it's good. Okay, so this is just a new way of talking about the power of the Buddhas, the power of the Dharma, right, to effect positive change, something like that. You could even think of it maybe as self-power being a kind of code word for traditional institutionalized Buddhism, which these people are essentially critiquing, right? But they can't say, you know, something like that. So that's the way I see it.
Is that why Honen talks about sundry practices versus the Nembutsu?
Yeah, so sundry practices means all those other practices that are not Nembutsu, and nothing wrong with them, but they just don't have the power of the Nembutsu.
They don't acquire merit.
Right. They do acquire merit.
Yeah.
Oh, they produce merit.
Oh,
yeah.
The
problem is that the merit won't be sufficient for you to attain Nirvana.
Oh, okay.
We're not
capable of getting there from here.
Yeah, we can produce a lot of merit, and if you do that, you'll get a good rebirth. It's not a bad thing to do. But if you want to really become a Buddha or get to Nirvana, you need more. Unless you're really, really spectacular. I mean, Shandao and Honen both say there are people who become Buddha. There are people who achieve it that way. Out of 1,000, there's 3 or 4 people. They recognize it's possible. They don't say it's not possible. If you happen to be one of those 2 or 3 in 1,000, but the Shinran would come along and say, if you think you're one of those 2 or 3, that's already a problem. So I think when you get to Shinran, it's no longer like intellectually acceptable. There could be some people. Oh, those people, but not me, you know? So,
yeah. Take a look in the mirror.
Yeah. Yeah.
Thank you.
Okay. Questions? No? Yeah.
How does Buddha nature relate to the three Buddha bodies theory?
The Buddha nature is in all three Buddha bodies, so it doesn't really make any difference. In Nirvana Sutta, for example, talks about 2 Buddha bodies. So some Buddhists have 2, some have 3, some have 4. But basically, in Nirvana Sutta, there's the physical body, and then there's the Dharma body, okay? And the Nirvana Sutra, Shakyamuni and the Nirvana Sutra says very clearly the mistake that everybody's making in coming here because I'm dying, because the Nirvana is his death here, is that you think that my physical death means something, but in fact my physical body doesn't mean anything, because the true body is only the Dharma body, and the Dharma body has no form, and Buddha nature has no form either, okay, something like that. So it kind of looks like the, and to put it in Nirvana Sutra terms, the physical body is an upaya, it's a means, an expediency that's used in order to communicate something that has no form, which most people find hard to grasp, right? So therefore I'm here as a human, I look human, and I speak and I use language, you know, and I use all these kind of relativistic things, and my life only lasts for 80 years and all this kind of stuff. But in fact, that's not what the essence of this is about. Something like that. Cool.
Well, you have a Q&A session after.
Yeah. We have a Q&A. So
yeah.
You have Q&A.
We're the half hour break.
Okay.
And then a Q&A session with you.
That's here?
Yeah, here from 3 to 4.
Okay. Good.